come to us, come like the rain.
Good evening, One Line, to all of our volunteers, all of our contributors and leaders here at One Line. This is a little bit different than we anticipated gathering this evening, but here we are nonetheless. Thanks for joining us online. This is a super, super important experience. So glad that you're here tuning in. If you happen to hear any loud commotion in the background, pounding, that's because our roofers decided to start working on this part of the roof just as we started filming. But we are going to push through. We are excited about what's going to be taking place tonight, what we're going to be uniting around this evening. I want to show you a post, a social media post from 2 years ago. This is actually on my personal social media page. This isn't the church's page. It's my post from 2 years ago. It says, "The first of many Sundays, join us at 10 a.m. And the hashtags are Westline Church, One Church Wheaton, Better Together, and Helping People Find Their Way Back to God." Here's what that means, is that 2 years ago this month, we gathered together in this room for the very first time on a Sunday morning. 2 years ago this month. I was reflecting on that this week, and I was almost in disbelief that it had only been 2 years. And here's the question that I found myself in my quiet time asking. God, how were you able to do all of this in just 2 years? Seriously, how could God have done all of this in just 2 years? A dozen baptisms, 300 people that now call One Line Church our church home. Again, when this post happened, we didn't even have a church name. We were 4 months from our grand opening. And that was just 2 years ago, and now 300 people call One Line their church home. We've begun a capital campaign called Making Room, where we're accelerating the mission of helping people find their way back to God. All of this, 2 years. How did it happen? Well, obviously, make no mistake. This is a story that God is writing. And you and I both know that when God is leading, He does what only He can do. When God is writing the story and we are simply following, then He's going to surpass our expectations. He's going to do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine, and that is exactly what He's done in the last 2 years. But something I love about our God, it's that He allows us, you and me, to be a part of it. In fact, He invites us to be a part of it. He chooses to use everyday, ordinary people like us, you and me, to bring hope to the world. And so as contributors and leaders at One Line, that's who's gathering here this evening, anyone who contributes in any way on any team across all of our different ministries or is a leader in any of our different ministries, we've gathered together. And to you, I want to say, you have led the way. You have led the way. You've opened up your heart to new families who 2 years ago when this post was made had no idea that One Line Church was even going to exist. And now they've made their way through our doors. They've made their way into our small groups. They've made their way onto our teams, into our homes. And you have welcomed them. You've opened up your hearts to them. You've put aside what was comfortable and you've put aside what was familiar. And you embraced the mission of Jesus. And you've embraced it in a way that I personally hadn't experienced it before. And I'm honored to lead us. I can speak for our staff. We're honored to lead you as your church staff. But at the end of the day, the group that's gathered here, the group of you that's listening to this right now, you are the most important group of people at our church. You are the ones who are leading the way. You are the ones who are setting the pace. You are an example that I wish that the entire world could get a glimpse of, to see what you have done and how you've led over the past couple of years. You're a picture of what Jesus meant when He said, if anyone would come after me, if anyone essentially wants to be my disciple, they must deny themselves. You're a picture of that. You're a picture of what Jesus meant when He said that His followers would take up their cross. You've done that. And it's truly remarkable. I love that all of us get to be a part of the story that God is writing here. Nick's going to be sharing with us a little bit tonight, and before he does that, I just want to take a second to share some wins with all of you, wins that we all get to experience, and some of these wins we don't get a chance to really spend time on a Sunday morning, at least in the way that I wish that we could, so we're going to do that right now. Reclaim 13. You hear us talk about Reclaim 13 in updates and through check-ins on Facebook at our weekend experiences. But Reclaim 13 is one of the ways that we've seen God win. And Reclaim 13, as you know, is an organization that is committed to recovering girls from sex trafficking. We get to be a key part of that organization. We get to be a key part of providing compassion bags for girls as they're recovered from sex trafficking. But also, we have been a partner with Reclaim 13 in a way that has helped them over the past year, just a few months back, open up their very first house to serve girls who are 18 and older. Prior to that, their opportunity to serve girls ended at when they turned 18, and now they're able to continue serving these girls. Go Ministries, that's another win that we've been able to experience over the past year. We continue to grow as a partner with Go, and one area that I want to highlight is in the area of church planting. If you know anything about One Line, you know that we are a church planting church. When God called us to bring two churches together, we knew that it would be about us planting churches across Chicagoland, but also churches all over the globe. And Go, our partner, we really consider them an extension of us. We consider them to be us. They consider us to be them. And Go has a vision to plant 1,000 churches in 10 years. And guess what? This isn't just something that we're giving money to and we write a check each month, but we are such a huge part, a practical part of what's taking place with Go and planting these 1,000 churches. Now, we're a leading partner. In fact, Nick, he is a lead trainer and coach for church planters for Go, specifically in the Dominican, but that's also expanding. And currently, Nick is coaching and training 70 pastors through Go. And that's an extension of us, One Line. That's an extension of you and your leadership and what we get to do. And through God's anointing and through His grace, Go is now expanding church planting into Mexico, Argentina, and the United States. We're actually leading the charge for planting churches in the United States, and we're going to be gathering in December for our very first meeting to talk about what does it look like for us to plant churches across the United States through Go Ministries. We have a church plant taking place right now in Montana, one taking place in Kansas City, also in Arizona, that we get to lead and be a part of seeing those churches come to life. Our food pantry that happens every single week, we're now serving around 40 families per week. And our team of volunteers making that happen continues to grow. Those are some of the opportunities that we've been able to celebrate and the ways that we've seen God working. In addition to that, we've seen financial wins over the past several months. And you've heard me share some of those about our giving being on pace. And I'm continually blown away by your generosity every single week. In addition to your general fund giving, we're giving above and beyond to our Making Room campaign. In fact, Making Room, that initiative continues to move forward. Like I said, you might be hearing the hammering right now. As we speak, our roof is being replaced. The expansion of our Connection Center is taking place, and we're looking forward to a few months from now, through your generosity, when we're going to be able to welcome neighbors and friends and family members here for the very first time in our brand new Connection Center. And again, the wins, they could just go on and on and on, because the story that God is writing is remarkable. But I want to shift gears for the next few minutes, just before Nick comes up to share with us, because part of what we want to accomplish this evening is to become even more unified around our mission. And a phrase that I've been reflecting quite a bit on over the past year is that if you commit to your what and are consumed by your why, you'll figure out the how. I want to say that again. If us as a church commit to the what and are consumed by your why, you'll figure out the how. And so I started thinking about this and reflecting on what does this look like for One Line? What does it mean for us to commit to our what? What is our what? What is it that we do here at One Line? What are we committing to? Or maybe another way to think about it, what are we going all in for? At the end of the day, what is it that we're taking up our cross for and denying ourselves for and sacrificing for? Well, we want every person, every single person, begins with you as contributors and leaders, who calls One Line their church home, to be what we call a C3 follower of Jesus. Again, it's what Nick's going to be expanding on tonight as we launch our most important initiative of the year. And I say of the year, but truthfully, this might be our most important initiative in the next 5 years. So what is a C3 follower of Jesus? Well, hopefully you've been tuning in for our Everyday Disciple series. But a C3 follower of Jesus is a follower of Jesus who continues to connect with God, to connect with other believers, and to connect with their purpose. That is our what. I hope if you take anything away from tonight that you remember that is what we do. We will continue to multiply C3 followers of Jesus. And I believe that the three most important questions that you will ever ask is, how is my connection with God? How is my connection with people? And how is my connection with my purpose? Because if any of those three connections are missing in your life, you will feel like something is missing. All of us, you and me, no matter how far along we are in our spiritual journey, all of us are unfinished. We must never stop encouraging each other to grow and to take a next step in those three areas. Because I believe to my core, with everything in me, that if you commit to always taking next steps with those three connections, it will transform your life. And as I mentioned, we've been in the series Everyday Disciple, spending 8 weeks talking about rhythms of following Jesus, rhythms of what it means to be a C3 follower of Jesus. Now, these napkins, they've got a little graphic on them. You might have seen them floating around in our hospitality areas on the weekend. You've seen us talk about the nine on the weekends. But these are rhythms that if you look throughout the scriptures, throughout the gospels, these are rhythms of following Jesus, rhythms that are essential for your connection with God, with each other, and with your purpose. That's our what, to continue to multiply followers of Jesus that connect with God, with each other, and with their purpose. That's our what. But why do we do it? We do that because we want to be relentlessly committed to helping people find their way back to God. We'll multiply C3 followers of Jesus. We'll help people find their way back to God. And what we're about to launch in the coming weeks and months is going to take us to the next level. I hope that you'll join me and commit to what God's calling us to in the coming months. I'm going to pray for us and for our night, and we're going to hear from Nick about what it means for us moving forward. Let's pray. God, thanks for this moment that we have to really spend some time as the leaders of One Line Church. God, you have called us to an important work. You've called us to the most important mission in the world. And I pray that tonight will be a moment for us to take a step forward in our unity around this mission. God, this what that you have called us to. That we will wake up looking to multiply followers of Jesus that connect with you, with each other, and with their purpose. We pray this in your name. Amen.
In the 1730s and the 1740s, there was something called the Great Awakening. It was a movement of followers of Jesus and people becoming followers of Jesus across Europe and across America, and it affected millions and millions of lives. Millions of people found their way back to God at that time, and one of the major players at that time was a guy named George Whitefield. He was really an incredible guy. As I've spent more time studying him, I've learned a lot of really interesting facts about him. First of all, he gave 18,000 sermons in his lifetime. He's actually credited with preaching and sharing the gospel through messages more often than he actually slept. George Whitefield was a pretty incredible guy. He was obviously instrumental in the Great Awakening at the time. And what I learned actually most recently was he was considered North America's first celebrity, meaning that the majority of people knew who he was, and it is recorded as 10 million different people, and this is between Britain and North America at the time, heard his voice. He shared sermon after sermon after sermon. He was an incredible teacher and preacher at the time. Ben Franklin actually studied him at one point, and Ben Franklin recorded that George Whitefield's voice could be heard by more than 30,000 people at a time. I mean, that's just incredible. He had some ability as an orator to just share the message incredibly loud to a huge audience of people. Later in his life, he was quoted by saying this phrase. He said, "I would rather wear out than rust out. He was a man committed to sharing sermons and preaching sermons. He wanted to wear out while he was preaching. In fact, he died shortly after that. Towards the end of his life, he was sharing with some of his friends. He said, in this confession, he said, "I neglected my people." He was reflecting over all the sermons he had given. He was reflecting over his entire ministry that was just sharing sermons, just preaching. And incredible movements happen. Incredible things happen with the Spirit of God and in those messages. But he was saying in a confession, "I neglected my people." And he called them, "They are now a rope of sand." I actually shared this story in the Dominican. And the Dominicans at the time in the translation said, they kind of raised their hand. They said, "Nick, that's not a thing. That's not possible. There's no such thing as a rope made out of sand. It would just crumble in your fingertips." I said, "That's exactly why George Whitefield said that. Because everything he had built his entire life had become like sand and disintegrated, and there was nothing left." In fact, he actually said, "As I look at the Wesley brothers, John Wesley, their model, their investment in different groups of people, their investment in discipleship has carried on, and I should have leaned my ministry into that. I neglected to train the people, I neglected to develop them, and I neglected to disciple them." Sometimes I wonder about church. As I've seen churches work throughout all of the world, I haven't been everywhere in the world, but I've seen all these models throughout the world, and in several countries I've been able to see God at work in different models of the church. I look at the North American church, I even look at one line and I say, yeah, Sunday morning's a really important part, but I look at what George Whitefield said, and I want to make sure that we're learning from the people who shaped our churches, from the people who shaped this movement. I don't want to build our ministry on a rope of sand. I certainly don't want everything to be built on a message only. There's got to be something more than that. We have to pursue discipleship. And we've been talking about that over the past few weeks. We've been talking about that as a church. We've been praying over that as a staff. And I have this deep conviction that we want to make sure that we're moving our church towards discipleship, every single one of us. And in the midst of me kind of reflecting on everything that we've done, even everything I've done in my own career over the past 20 years, I begin to think back over all the different small groups I've been able to lead or been in charge of or be able to be a part of, and I celebrate all the amazing things that God has done. Even here at One Line, we have story after story of what God has done within our small groups. In our small groups, we've talked about having these kind of core principles and values that drive all of our small groups. We wanted every single small group to connect people who weren't connected. We want every single small group to multiply groups and leadership. And we want every single small group to grow each person in C3, in our three connects, our connection to God, our connection to others, and our connection to our purpose. That's what we want to see happen in every one of our small groups. And as I look over the past, so much to celebrate. Incredible moments of generosity within our small groups. Incredible moments of people loving people and celebrating and being there when things get really challenging in our small groups. And we're really, really exceptional at connecting people and living life with one another. We love to be with one another. We are incredible at that, One Line. Well done with that part. But as I look over the nine, what we've been talking about, as I look over what it means to be a disciple and how we connect to God, others, and your purpose, I'm not sure I continue to see that depth. I'm not sure I continue to see discipleship at that level. And so I want to make sure we learn from the models of the past, we learn from the models that Christ gave us, and we learn from the models that have been successful in the movements of discipleship. And so as I look into the past and look into the foundation of what Scripture gives us, one of the main places that I see in our history and in the history of the world and the history of the church is I love taking a look at the model of Jesus. Jesus gathered in these rhythms of life. He gathered in these different size gatherings on a regular basis. In fact, at the very end of his life, in the Great Commission, he says, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them the ways that I have commanded you and taught you, and surely I'm with you to the very end of the age." But what are those ways? Well, Jesus modeled it for us. He had larger groups that he gathered with. He had medium-sized groups that he gathered with and smaller groups that he gathered with. The larger groups were 50 and sometimes many more. The medium-sized groups were the disciples, certainly on a regular basis he gathered with them. And then he gathered with this smaller, more intimate and tight group of three. I also see that same pattern as I look at the ministry of John Wesley, the one who George Whitefield pointed back to. And in John Wesley's model, he has this incredible model that we see where he had societies, classes, and bands. The societies were groups of 50 or a little bit more, but in the societies, that was just an incredible place for people to grow and to celebrate and to do work together, to do the mission of God together. And then there was something a little bit different about a class. A class was 10 to 12, and inside there was a different experience because of the size of the group and what could happen in that space. And then also there was the band. And within the band, it was called a close conversation, a close interaction with just a few. And something different can happen in that kind of a space than can happen in others. And so I want to make sure we pay special attention to what happened there. And the way that I want to make sure we visit that is I want to talk about rhythms. This entire teaching series, we've been talking about the rhythms of discipleship. And if you don't remember how we've defined rhythm, I want to go back to that pure definition of rhythm. A rhythm is a strong, consistent flow of movement through time. I want to make sure, and we want to make sure, that the rhythms of discipleship are moving us strongly and consistently through time towards Jesus. That's what it means to be a follower of Jesus, and that's what we hope for. And so as we look at the nine, which we've been going through this entire series, the one area that I want to make sure we lean into really carefully and very intentionally is connection with others. Our connection with others is a huge and important part of our own discipleship. And so I want to make sure that we are expanding on that, focusing on that, and really giving it time. So when we look at the nine, specifically connecting with others, it is huddle, D-group, and then guide. And so I am incredibly excited about our intentionality about moving discipleship forward here at One Line. We're doing that through something we call C3 Communities. And it's going to look a little bit different than maybe something we've done in the past. You're going to see some familiarities of things we've done in the past, but we're making an intentional shift. I'm asking you to come along with us as we do this because I really believe as we look at the model of Jesus, look at the model of John Wesley, look at other models we've seen that have been successful around our intentional growth with God, our intentional followership as a disciple of Jesus, that our C3 Communities will be an incredible way for us to do that. And so let me unpack for you the new rhythm of discipleship here at One Line. And I want you to come along with me as we do that. So the new rhythm at One Line starts with something we call C3 Communities. A C3 Community is made up of about 50 people. And in that 50 people, they would gather about 3 times a year. Those 50 people would gather about 3 times a year, and in those gatherings, they may do something that's celebratory. We've experienced that a couple times where we've seen multiple small groups gather in one place. And so what we like to do is gather all of these groups of 50 together under one place made up of multiple huddles. And I'm going to talk about what that means here in a moment. That would gather 3 times a year of 50 people. I can see incredible things happening when these 50 people gather 3 times a year. First of all, celebration is incredibly fun. I love when we get multiple people together in one place. It's so much fun. There's a lot of energy that can happen in that space, and it creates a ton of memories of gathering differently like that. So that's a super fun way that we can do that as a church. But our connection with others goes beyond that because when we get together, it's more than simply celebrating. It could also be doing something that makes a huge difference in our community. Think about the ability to do something missional or incarnational, literally bringing the presence of Jesus to a community. What could you do if you had 50 people all together in the same space all at once? Imagine going to a neighborhood that needs your help, or going to a single person's home or an elderly person's home who needs some help, or going to an organization and just coming in with an army of 50 people to do something a few times a year to make an enormous difference. Imagine what we could do together if we gathered our huddles together of people, 50 different people, to do something significant in our community. So it could be something that's missional. It could be something that's celebratory. It could be a simpler way that we serve together. But in the rhythm of a community of 50 people, where we want 50 people to gather together, we can see some incredible things that would happen. And the rhythms, as we look at our lives, would be we would meet with those 50 people 3 times a year. That's a C3 community, okay? A C3 community. 50 people 3 times a year who could celebrate, do something missional, and serve together. So I love the new rhythm of C3 communities, gatherings of 50 people that can do incredible things. But I'd mentioned the idea of huddles a moment ago. Now, in the past, we've done small groups, and small groups have really been phenomenal. They've been the lifeblood of our church in many ways and done an incredible job at community and connecting the unconnected. But again, we're leaning into a rhythm that causes us to draw towards Christ, to be a follower of Jesus, to be a disciple. And so what does a rhythm of a disciple look like? Well, inside of a group of 50, we will have different huddles. And these will look like and feel like our traditional small groups. But we're renaming them so we can kind of reframe the way that we think about them. Here's what the rhythm of a huddle would look like. First of all, a huddle would be about 10 to 12 people. Also, a huddle would gather twice a month, okay? So our C3 community would gather 3 times a year. Our huddles would gather 2 times a month. Within this size group, we can see incredible things happening, much like what we've seen before. There could be scripture-guided conversations. I love the 5-question exploring scripture together. And I will go in further into what that looks like in further trainings with our leadership. But I wanted to talk to you about what can happen in a huddle. Many of the same things that we've experienced in our small group together. This is a space that feels a lot like life together. This is the same space that we celebrate the joys of our individual lives, but we also walk with one another. This is a place that the joys and challenges get shared. A place where we can pray for each other. Place where we regularly connect twice a month. Now imagine the rhythm of your life day in and day out. There are things that happen on a regular basis, and meeting twice a month with a group of people that you love doing life together with. And of course you can meet outside of this, but this is the intentional rhythm we're trying to create so that we can develop our own discipleship. We can fall into the pattern and rhythm of discipleship here at One Line. A group of 10 to 12 people meeting twice a month, who share life together, who are with one another, the joy and challenges of life, and praying for each other. Again, I love this new rhythm, this intentional rhythm of our own discipleship here at One Line. C3 communities, groups of 50. Within that group of 50, we have multiple huddles that gather together that make up that group of 50. Our huddles are groups of 10 to 12. But this is something unique. The next part of our discipleship that we need to lean into and be very intentional with about how we do discipleship here at One Line. Our connection with God, our connection with others, and our connection with our purpose. We want to make sure we're creating space for that. And so let me introduce to you D groups. D groups are a new rhythm that we haven't had. Some of you may have had something like this in the past, or maybe you're currently doing something like this, but let me help you understand what we're thinking about within D groups. D groups, the rhythm of a D group would be 3 to 5 people. Those 3 to 5 people would meet 1 time a month, or maybe 2 times a month. One to two times monthly. These would be very intentional meetings. These are spaces with a smaller group of people where we may feel more comfortable sharing things that would be more challenging to share in a larger group environment. Imagine some of the most challenging things in your life. Maybe there's sin in your life, or maybe there are challenges in your private life that you want to talk to somebody about. And in a large group, it's harder to share that. But in the intimacy, in the intentionality, and relational connection of a smaller group of people, it is more safe to share it with them. This is an environment in which we can lean into trust. This is an environment where we can share privately and relationally with a few other people who we ultimately want to be and be held accountable to being that woman or that man or that person that God has called us to be in our own purpose. So we can be held accountable. This is a space that in the privacy of our own lives, that we can share out of the darkness that sometimes seems to haunt us. At least in my life, I know this is true. As I've spent my life talking to other believers, one of the things that consistently comes up is that people are so ashamed of their own sin. They're so ashamed of the things in their life that is not of God and not as God would want for them, but they don't ever have a place to share that. And in an environment like this, with 3 to 5 people, that's meeting 1 to 2 times monthly, that is established with trust, that is built on accountability, that is created for that more specific and intentional environment, we now have a space where we can share sin with one another and not let evil have its grasp on us any longer. This is a place where we can be held accountable and walk intentionally with other people. Over the next few months, we are going to have a very intentional path where we can create our own strategy, our own process of how we are going to set goals for our own life spiritually. So as we follow Jesus, we can intentionally be held accountable to those things. We can grow in our own discipleship, and we can set what I want to call as goals. This is a pretty unique environment. An environment that hasn't happened naturally for a lot of people. And I haven't seen a lot of churches doing this, but as I look throughout history, I see Jesus doing this. I see John Wesley doing this. I see movements across the world where the gospel is growing and people are finding their way back to God. And this is a powerful part, almost a foundational part of their faith journey. A place where 3 to 5 people gather. That meets 1 to 2 times monthly, built on trust, accountability, a place where you can safely share sin and not be ashamed any longer, a place where you can set goals for your own spiritual life as a follower of Jesus. So as we create a new rhythm around discipleship, I'm asking for you to trust us. I'm asking for you to come along for the ride and have the courage to try this rhythm that we see so prevalent throughout the world in places where the gospel is growing. Because ultimately, what we want to build here at One Line and in your life, as you look back on your own life over the last several years, as I stand here after working and leading and living in leadership of a church and churches over the last 20 years, I look at my ministry and I look over my shoulder and I say, look, I want to make sure they're not building a ministry that's going to turn out to be a rope of sand. I want to build with you. I want all of us to build together a discipleship path, an intentional growth path here at One Line where we can celebrate what God is doing in each and every one of us. And we are going to move forward with that in what we call C3 communities. Our C3 communities are groups of 50, made up of huddles of 10 to 12, made up of D groups who regularly gather of 3 to 5. Each of these spaces created uniquely and with an intentional rhythm that fits into your life so that you can grow in your followership of Jesus. I'm so excited about what God is doing and is going to continue to do in the coming months and years here at One Line. I can't even wait for the stories to begin unfolding about what God is doing in your life and the life of everyone here at One Line, and I cannot wait to share with you those stories. God is moving here through each and every one of us, and it is so exciting to be on the cusp of something incredible like this. So will you join with me as we move into the new phase of our discipleship here at One Line of C3 communities? And I'm sure there's lots of questions, and we are learning as we're going as well, but we thought through a lot of the pieces, and I want to share with you some of the stuff that's coming, because some of you are probably thinking about, well, how does the leadership work with this? Well, here's what it does, is we need a leader to lead our C3 communities, somebody who will lead and oversee and coach those huddles within there. So we will have a few different C3 communities. We need leaders who are going to lead our huddles. And those leaders who are leading those huddles will be developing the group and making sure these pieces happen within our huddles that meet twice a month. And we also need leaders who will lead these D groups. Now, I do see our D groups will probably be part of our huddles. You'll see maybe two or three D groups that come out of each of our huddles, okay? And how do we develop leadership for that? Well, a lot of our small group leaders are natural fits for huddle leaders. It naturally flows into what a huddle looks like. And so we're moving away from small groups and moving in to C3 communities. And our small group leaders will become huddle leaders. It'll be a natural transition for them. But just like every level of leadership here at One Line, we want every leader to identify and develop an apprentice. And so there will be trainings for all the levels of leadership. There will be training and coaching for those who will lead C3 communities. There will be training and coaching for those who will lead our huddles, and there'll be training and coaching for those who lead D groups. There will even be content and strategy around the content that we want to see unpacked here in our huddles as we explore Scripture together through our 5 questions. There will be content and strategy around helping each other be held accountable to our spiritual growth of our D groups. I am excited about what God's doing. As I look at Scripture, as I look at the movements from our past and ongoing, I cannot tell you how excited I am about what God is doing here at One Line and what's going to happen through our C3 communities. Thanks so much for joining me. We will have training coming up. We'll have some information about that. And if you're curious about, what about our classes? Maybe you're curious about financial peace or maybe Rooted or some of the other classes you've been a part of or maybe some Bible studies. Those will continue on too. And we will continue to have classes and opportunities here at One Line. But this is something we want for all of our members, all of our adults at One Line. We want them to experience a C3 community. So thanks so much for joining us tonight. But here's the deal. I don't ever want to move forward without God first. I want to make sure that as we look to what's happening, it's an only God moment. And so I'm going to ask that you pray with me. I've been praying for months leading up to this moment right here as the beginning of this conversation about what discipleship looks like here at One Line. And so I'm going to ask, will you pray with me right now? Will you join me in prayer and bow your head and ask God to lead this forward, to make sure that we are aligning to what we see in Scripture. We're aligning to what the Holy Spirit is saying. We are aligning to exactly what He wants for us here at One Line. Will you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, it seems like this moment has been coming for a very long time. And I'm so excited about our learnings from the past and all the good things that have happened in the past. And God, I'm so excited about what you're shaping here at One Line. And I ask that you search us, that you refine us, you give us the courage to be part of something new that may feel different for each of us, God. But I'm asking, God, give us the courage to explore our C3 communities as we drive towards discipleship with you. God, we love you. We want the rhythms of our lives to be reflections of you. We don't want our lives or our spiritual lives to be a rope of sand. We want to look over our shoulder and say, look what God did. So God, will you instill in us the rhythms of following you? Help these rhythms to permeate our lives. God, lead every moment of this. We trust you. We give all of this to you. And we are so thankful that you are leading here at One Line. We love you, Lord. It's your name that we pray. Amen.